third of five lectures we've composed around the Hattie Saucy exhibition, and I'm pleased to say that it features one of our strongest student interns we've had to date. The core mission here is to provide students with opportunities they otherwise would not have had they gone to the university without an art museum. The goal is to make the museum relevant. We don't put the museum on a pedestal. We make it part of the classroom. And we make the art instruments of education. And I'm pleased to say that Larissa Randall now has publishing credits as an undergraduate, which is a great thing. And she will serve her very well in the future. Larissa Randall is class of 2018. She's a double major in art history and studio art. She first began working with us here at the museum as a freshman. She stood out, and when I was in the second year of the Hattie Saucy research project moving toward the exhibition, I interviewed a number of students, and again, Larissa stood far and above all others, and we offered her the internship in the spring of 2016. She came on board, she quickly caught up with the research I'd carried out, and I approached her and said, this is the full picture, but what aspect of Hattie Saucy did you want to approach? And she was particularly drawn to the figural work, the portraiture, and the influence of Cecilia Poe. And that aspect is something that we had not known about Hattie Saucy prior to this exhibition. There had never been published proof uncovered that Saucy was in fact exhibiting alongside Cecilia Beaux, and that the two women actually knew each other, and that Beaux actually gave Saucy the Gold Prize in 1912. So after she joined us as an intern, she was later appointed to Omicron Delta Kappa, where she now serves as vice president, and she is a senator of the Student Government Association. She also approached the Undergraduate Research Fund last year to discuss her research on the project and her desire to present the research at the Association of Academic Museums and Galleries annual convention and symposium, this year held in Eugene, Oregon. And the fund awarded her a generous grant, which will cover all costs of travel and attendance at the conference. So she and I will be going to Eugene, Oregon in June. Quite nice. And even more exciting, or equally exciting, I should say, a few weeks ago, Stephanie Hyde presented a lecture here about the art scene of New York in 1908 when Hattie Saucy first came to New York. And we had extensive conversations with Larissa. And during those conversations, Stephanie Hyde offered Larissa a summer internship at the Hyde, where she'll serve as Dr. Hyde's research assistant. And for those of you who don't know, Stephanie Hyde is the Stint Family Curator of American Art at the Hyde Museum. So all that said, young woman, junior year, accomplished a great deal already. So it's my privilege to introduce Larissa Randall.
Hello, everybody. when John first invited me on for this project in the spring of 2016, I wasn't sure what exactly I wanted to focus on. I thought maybe I would focus on Hattie Saucy's narrative, but then once we discovered the relationship between her and Cecilia Beaux, I couldn't stop. Cecilia Beaux is a name that comes up a lot in art history now, retrospectively. I was familiar with her and I was excited that they were paralleled with one another and just to research her in general. I'm an art history and painting major, as he said, when I was little. I always wanted to be an artist. I didn't know how I would get there and that I would come to this interest in art history along the way, but I'm very fortunate to have these opportunities. The work we're doing here is especially important because these women aren't getting the recognition they deserved in their lifetime. This is the early 20th century at the cusp of Impressionism. And the only woman getting any credit is Mary Cassatt, and that still is not as much as she deserved. Working retroactively is very important, and I'm very excited that I got to contribute at all. So to start off, I have this chronology of some significant dates of Cecilia and Patty. I apologize if it overlaps with some of the information that Dr. Hyde mentioned for some of you who were there. But Cecilia was born in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, 35 years before Patty Saucy. This is especially significant because later, when she's more acclaimed, she'll be invited to be the first female instructor at the Pennsylvania Academy of Fine Arts ever, which is great. She went to a myriad of institutions, but when she went to the Academy of Leon in 1888, it was particularly significant because not only did they not have very many women there, but of the women who were there, they paid twice as much tuition as their male counterparts and didn't even get the same exposure to the model. So it was very courageous of her. Patty Saucy was then born in 1890 in Savannah, where she would eventually live in again. Beau moves to New York shortly before Patty. Patty and her mother moved there in 1908, and this is the period that I'm going to be focusing on the most. Patty's mother, Rachel, was very supportive of her artistic career. They had the means to support her, but they also recognized her talent from a very young age, and she was very fortunate in that. Together, Patty and Cecilia, most probably for the first time, but not explicitly, met in 1912 at the Catherine Collier Wolf Art Club. This club was particularly significant because it was founded by a woman for women amongst many clubs that were either just for men or men that happened to let some women show there. After her New York period, Saucy goes abroad and studies in Europe, which was the thing to do if you had the money in America at that time, because American education, though it wasn't that far below par, wasn't taken as seriously as if you had studied abroad. So she traveled around until World War I happened, when she came back to Washington, D.C. to help with the war effort. After that, her brother tragically passed away, and she moved back to Savannah to accompany her mother, who was widowed, for the rest of her life. Cecilia Beau, a few years later, publishes her autobiography, Background with Figures. And this is a very bold move, because she was more successful in her lifetime than Patty Saucy, but there weren't that many female artists publishing autobiographies, especially in their lifetime. Cecilia always had a very strong sense of self. She kept a diary since the age of 6, as her mother did. And most of those diary entries were compiled into this autobiography, which I highly recommend. Continues on, 1942, Cecilia Beau passed away, and then 1978 was the death of Patty Saucy. So, to kind of shed light on the lens that I'm approaching this analysis with, I'm going to touch on what I'm talking about when I'm talking about portraiture. So, portraiture, novelty, is people painting other people, which was especially impactful at this time because, the camera already existed, and a lot of people were saying, why are you continuing to do this? We don't need this anymore. But Cecilia Beau and Patty did a very great job of keeping portraiture relevant and interesting. On that vein, there's only so much creative power you have when you're doing portraits, especially as Cecilia Beau did, because most of hers were commissions. She had a much more utilitarian perspective. She viewed a portrait as a figure with a background, nothing in between. And as you can see, you either took the light or you were hidden by that, and there was nothing else to focus on here. Whereas Hattie, she, whether or not this had to do with that she was painting more for pleasure than for business, she had a much more harmonious view of her art. She wanted everything to be more cohesive. She utilized impressionistic influences a little bit more. And ultimately, I think she did art a little more for art's sake because she had the privilege to do so. This particular work is emblematic of this way of looking at portraiture that I'm talking about. This was by Hattie Zosby in the later portion of her life when she lived in Savannah. It's her dear friend Myrtle Jones, who was a fellow artist. They constantly pushed each other to do more with their work and challenge each other. And I think that really shows in the work in light of some of her other portraits, because first and foremost, the bright green that she's using in this like scarf is something she would typically only use in landscapes, and it definitely really catches your eye when you're looking at it. Similarly, she puts Myrtle in this posture that really commands power, and that's not something that a lot of women were painted like at this time. Either they were slightly to the side behind their husband, or they would bend over playing jacks with their children, but it's never like, look at this powerful, strong woman, especially if she's aging, and see that she's still feminine and beautiful, and she commands presence. So this is our most concrete evidence of perpetuating the relationship between Hattie Zosby and Cecilia Beaux. It's the February 1912 volume of American Art News, which was a very popular publication at the time. It talked about all the up-and-coming galleries and who was at them and who won at these shows. At this particular show, Hattie was awarded first prize. While we don't know what work it was that she was exhibiting at that time, it's especially relevant because Cecilia Beaux, the biggest name of the judges list here, was also the only judge who showed work at the exhibition. So having winning first prize just goes to show Cecilia had noticed her and admired how she was painting at this time. Also, Hattie got to see Cecilia's painting up close and personal, and after this 1908 to 1912 period, she started painting more courageously, particularly. Now, the work on our right, Aunt Eliza by Cecilia Beaux, it was a little before this 1908 period, but I'm bringing it up first and foremost because it really shows this distinct figure versus background contrast that Cecilia was perpetuating. The black of her attire versus the unfinished looking background was very harsh. This wasn't something you would see at this time, especially at like the exhibition level. Whereas Hattie, painting on the left, it's an undated work, but you can tell that she's turning to Cecilia, adopting new practices where she is focusing on the realist face, but not even paying attention to completing the figure. And applying paint much more deliberately and not as concerned about being fitting in with artwork that she might have thought was kitsch or inferior to her own. Also, Eliza on the right was Cecilia's aunt and really took care of Cecilia when she was growing up, and I think that kind of affects this narrative that she's putting into the portrait. Her mom passed away 12 hours after she was born, and her father left to Paris after that. So she was really raised by her aunt and her mother's parents. She admired her greatly. She looked at her as the epitome of what a woman ought to be. And Eliza, Cecilia put in her diary that Eliza said, "Remember, you are first of all a Christian, then a woman, then an artist." And that was something that Cecilia kind of lived by for the rest of her life. These are different than a lot of the work we have on view and a lot of the work I'm going to talk about. We don't have that many works on paper in particular, but the Morris has the largest collection of Zosby works on paper in their archives. As you can see, there is an uncanny resemblance here. There, Patty is looking to Cecilia and seeing, this is what she's doing. How can I keep that relevant and also make it my own? While Cecilia's doesn't look necessarily as realistic as Hattie's because she's using chalk, not graphite, and is a little older, their posture is exactly the same, and the high contrast in the hat versus the figure is almost identical, creating like strong silhouettes that really distinguish the figure from the background. Because again, I think like anything that isn't this person, isn't a part of this narrative, is an accessory to the portrait. Now, on the right, Helena DeCave Gilder here was a woman that Cecilia Bow painted very often and also painted her children very often. She didn't find her to be the warmest, but she admired her ability to care for her family. And I show it primarily because this is the kind of painting that Cecilia Bow was doing when Hattie got to see her work. So this is when she's walking to the Wolf Art Club, looking on the wall, seeing what is Cecilia Bow doing. This is how she's painting, and it's very different from anything she's seen before, especially in the South. And on the right, or on the left, you have Blue Pearls by Hattie Sassi. Most likely some model study, and not necessarily her most acclaimed work, but it's her attention to the figure is so similar to Cecilia Bow, and also when she's really trying to highlight the pearls here, the amount of effort she puts to still humanize this model and kind of relate her to the viewer is very admirable and very typical of her. This is kind of one of the most ornate backgrounds that Sassi really does. She doesn't usually put her figure right in front of this dramatic landscape that takes away from them. She uses the same color palette throughout because she wants you to see how this figure relates to where she is. Cecilia Bow's The Silver Box in the center here because it's the same painting and from the same time where Hattie would have been exposed to this work. But also on the left, Hattie's Woman in Red Kimono done a few, if not in while she was abroad, right when she got back from Europe, is in the same exact, it's composed the same way as Cecilia's, and she's paying attention to the drapery that Cecilia is doing in a very similar way without taking away from the model. The popularization of Japanese influences in Europe took place mostly in the 1860s. However, Hattie, being a woman from Savannah, with at this point only really strong American training, going abroad and noticing how these non-Western influences were growing in popularity, and being so keen on that trend really enforces how keen her artistic eye was, which is why I put it in contrast to Christopher Murphy's on the far right. He was a male Southern artist at the time of Hattie Sassi, who got a lot more recognition in his lifetime. However, he's not only noticing this trend much later, but he's also dramatizing the kimono without actually paying as much attention to the person who's wearing it. He loses the figure in this ornamentation because he doesn't appreciate the relationship building that Hattie Sassi thinks goes into these portraits. I digress. And here we have three self-portraits by Cecilia Bow. As I said before, she had a very strong sense of self. She painted dozens of self-portraits. So many, from when she was young and she felt like she was most attractive from until she stopped painting. On the left, we have one of her earlier ones, which I would argue is potentially a study for the far right portrait because she's using that same ochre yellow, and it looks like an underpainting, clearly when she was younger. Mm. On the right, we have her 1894 self-portrait, which when you Google Cecilia Beaux or look at any media popularly associated with her, this is the portrait that's going to come up, even though she in no way finds it to be her favorite, nor to be the one which is most beautiful. I think this one is so popular for a few reasons, mostly because it's not derivative, but you can see how heavily she was weighing with impressionist style, especially in the pattern of her blouse. And that was really appealing, and people understood it, and people could relate to that. Versus the one in the center, which I think Cecilia Beaux would hear much more, she's portraying herself as this powerful feminine figure in old age, which was something we didn't see that much, and kind of highlighting her matriarchal presence, which she was very proud of. You know, she's painting at a time where she's trying to compete with William Merritt Chase and John Singer Sargent, and she wants to be not just taken as seriously as them, but taken more seriously than them. And she was a very serious person, a very serious businesswoman. She often talks about commanding power, particularly in her self-portraits, which I think is something very admirable and something that a lot of people overlook when we're talking about portraiture and self. Now, I want to compare these two because while Hattie Saucy is painting what we now know is her mother, Rachel Saucy, on the left, it is very unlikely that she did not see Beaux' self-portrait. It was the first female self-portrait by an alive artist to be admitted into the Uffizi Gallery. It was very acclaimed. Everyone was talking about it. So later when she paints her mother with this same matriarchal presence, if you've been to the Center Gallery, you see this is the portrait where you walk around and her eyes kind of follow you. Like, she is in a very powerful stance, but they're not overshadowing their age. They aren't trying to inflate their wrinkles or dim the light so that you can't really tell how old they are as women. She embraces it and finds it to be something particularly beautiful. As I wrap this up, Hattie Saucy turned to Cecilia Beaux very often for her artistic career, but they differed a lot somewhat in how they carried out their day-to-day life. As I mentioned before, Cecilia painted for money, she painted for her livelihood, whereas Hattie painted her entire life, but for various reasons. You can see, she says, it's a very personal thing when you're painting, and it takes your mind, soul, and body. Hattie was a very spiritual woman, they both were. And it didn't detract from their painting, they embrace it very much so. But as they grew later in life, they definitely talked about it a lot more. Both of them were unmarried and they never had children. Cecilia Beaux did get several marriage proposals and in direct response to them would move to a different institution to continue focusing on her career. And I shed light on this, not just because as a painter, I think they're very talented and something I aspire to be, but because even though they were dejected artists in their time and didn't get the appreciation they deserved, they in no way viewed themselves as dejected women. They found themselves to be very powerful, very in touch with who they were, and they really were trying to keep relevant something they thought was very important and push the boundaries on it to fulfill their creative needs. And I think it's something very admirable that I can look up to and that we all.
So if Hattie had gone back to New York after 1915 and had gotten closer to Cecilia Beaux and other female artists in New York, what do you think would have happened?
I think that she definitely would have focused on portraiture and figural works a bit more than landscapes, especially later in her life. I think she would have gained more popularity, but I also don't really think that was very important to her. So I don't think she lost out when she went home to Savannah to be with her mom. Her career could have been a little more, but I think she was ultimately very happy.
Thank you, Lois. This was terrific. And this is just a question out of ignorance, but if you look at a painting, could you tell whether a woman painted it or a man painted it? Is that a trick question? And I ask that not, I mean,
yeah.
I assume, if I looked at that, maybe I'd assume it, but I'm not sure. And then you made the point about that they were given their due, and my guess is it's not because of their paintings themselves,
mm-hmm.
but because a woman. So, just trying to see that at the turn of the century, were people able to separate the art from the artist?
Right. We talk about that a lot in art and culture classes, the role of the male gaze in painting figural works. And I think it's not necessarily as much about if you can tell that a woman painted it. I think you can definitely tell when someone's painting themselves. I think it's a very intimate process, and I feel like typically it is more archetypal of the type of work that person is going to do. The same way when I've talked about this before with friends, the same way you take a picture of your significant other isn't the same way you take a picture of your mother. It's different when you take that picture, how you frame it, what you're going to do with that. And painting is the same way. So I think that the relationship between people, the artist and the person being painted, can be deduced from the work, but I don't think you can necessarily say, oh, a woman painted that. And I think people who do that typically have a loaded point of view.
In your research, was there ever any evidence that she had any contact, had associated with the Hatchet School or Robert Henry or any of those people?
I don't think so, unless you did. I know she worked under Spiker. I do think there's some very strong parallels between her and Whistler. But she had money. She was painting very differently than other people, especially after World War I.
I assume from what you said that your interest in Cecilia Beaux preceded Patty Saucy. I wondered if you could talk a bit about how far it goes back. Learning about Cecilia Beaux, was it a course here?
It wasn't in a course here. The first time I remember uncovering Cecilia Beaux is when I was flipping through this book that I have, Seeing Ourselves, Women's Self-Portraits. I saw it in a museum. When I was a little younger, and it was so expensive, so I bought on Amazon and read the whole thing when I got home. but this self-portrait of Celia was in it. Even in a book completely of women's self-portraits, nobody, or some do, but very few women paint themselves realistically while they're old. You know, like, I know a lot of people have seen Frida Kahlo's portraits. The way she's painting herself is completely different than the way Cecilia is painting herself. And I think it's brave, especially at this time.
Do you have any sense as to how going back to Savannah influenced her art? It was being taught at the Tel Fair or Harold Jones or Murphy or different minds that were painting in the community.
Mm-hmm. She did correspond with Murphy. I've seen a few letters, but I think when she returned to Savannah, she was definitely somebody who painted based off of her surroundings. So we have a lot of landscapes around the area on different plantations. But other than that, John.
I know that you mentioned several times about how Hattie Saucy had money of her own, so she didn't really need to paint to support herself. I think you also mentioned a lot that she was unmarried, didn't have kids, and I think, yeah, her mother went to cook care for her mother, so where did Hattie Saucy get her income from, especially after her mother passed away?
Old money.
Okay. So did she need to like supplement it in any way, or did she just have enough?
She sold works. She kept her favorites, but she did sell some. It's just, and I'm not saying that, oh, she had money, she isn't as important, but there's a difference, especially with portraits, when you're painting them for commission versus when you're painting them for yourself or as a gift, to get a little more creative agency, I think.
Can I
have
So one of the biggest things to keep in mind, by the time Hattie's born, there's so many cousins and there's so many branches of the Saucy and Barnegat families that everyone sort of just took care of Rachel and Hattie. It's not that she was a multimillionaire heiress, but there was enough family support to look after her so that when she built that house in 1926, it was just sort of taken care of. And she lived quietly. She was not an extravagant woman.
Questions? You mentioned that, this is a general question, that a lot of artists during this time period looked into other influences other than the West, you know, Western, you talked about how Japanese books.
Yep.
And I'm thinking how cultural culture mold, and we talked about how Van Gogh said works, you know, different. Why the fix for?
Well, artists respond to change. So, before the age where we have so much media now, they hadn't seen things like this, and they thought it was very interesting. That happened more in the late 19th century, I think. People kind of dramatized and even fetishized non-Western influences to the point where it was almost inappropriate. But it was always out of curiosity, I think, especially Japanese, with the Van Gogh you're talking about. Woodcuts, Japanese woodcuts in particular, were so flat, and that wasn't something that these European or Southern American artists had ever seen before. So they just wanted to be like, wow, how can I make this my own?
Any connection to the suffragette movements and their lifetime between maybe 20, 30 years old? Or
I do not think there was between Hattie. I know there wasn't between Hattie, and I don't think it was with Cecilia, though. I think they still, especially Cecilia Bowe, she's a businesswoman, you can only say so much without getting penalized.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Did they overlap with Grant Cassell?
Mm-hmm.
Came back? They did?
Cecilia voted.
Yeah.
And I read in one of her diary entries something about how Grant Cassell was really amazing. Or something along those lines. She paints like a man.
Yeah.
Well, thank you all for coming, and we're going to keep the galleries open a little bit longer if you'd like to stay and discuss this with Marissa.
Mm-hmm.